Skip all that. Most of the important stuff you have here, I teach at NYU. I've been here since September. Before that, I lived for 3 years in Lithuania. And most of what I'm going to be talking about today is born out of my experiences during those 3 years living in Lithuania and a couple other ideas. So now I'm officially beginning. So thank you all for coming. Thanks to Laura for the extremely short introduction. And there are a lot of words in this title. And I'll get to all of them over the next 50 minutes, because some of them may be completely unfamiliar, especially steampunk. But like I said, I'll get to all of them. But before I do that, I want to sort of describe the moment of this, of what I'm going to be talking about. So this talk is mostly about a novel called Vilkovalanda that I don't expect anyone to have read here. The novel was written by Andrius Tapinas, who was born in 1977, and it was published in Lithuanian in Lithuania in 2013. The tagline here reads, "Breathtaking adventures in a different or other Vilnius." So the novel has been translated into English as Hour of the Wolf. This is available on Amazon as an ebook. The translation is not very good. But Vilkovalanda is, as are many contemporary literary works, a piece of transmedia storytelling. So we've got the novel already, then we've got the English translation. There's a graphic novel that's the prequel to the novel that stars the main character of Vilkovalanda, Anthony Silver. Then there's a sequel, as you can tell from the cover, it takes place partly in Kaunas. There's a website that explains, that features a lot of the art from the novel that was made by Agnes Zoma, as well as brief essays about what's true, what isn't true about the novel, what is steampunk, for example. And then there's even a game, a video game that's available in the App Store or on Google Play. And to this large list already of things that create this whole world that Tapinas has invented, we can add various animated adaptations, little film clips. At the Vilnius Book Fair last year, he had people dressed up as zombies in a cage to sort of advertise the book. Now, it's unclear whether this whole world he's created is transmedia storytelling proper, where the idea is that you create all these different kinds of forms of media in order to build this huge world, or whether he's just really good at marketing and knows how to get all these little niches and build up his brand that way. But the point is that all this has had the effect of creating quite a sensation in Lithuania that has lodged the books on the bestseller lists, and Vilkovalanda itself was won Book of the Year in 2013. Not so bad for a first-time novelist. Because Tapinas was known earlier as, and is still largely known as, a journalist, television presenter. He has television shows, op-ed writer, and he translated Lord of the Rings into Lithuanian. So nevertheless, with all these objects, he has still managed to create something that is a hybrid. The settings of these works, all these novels, take place over a century ago, but he has these delivery systems, the e-books, the apps, all this kind of stuff is very much of this time. So there's this hybrid, 100 years ago and now. And doing this, making this kind of hybrid of times, is very steampunk. So what is steampunk? I'll now put up a couple photos and talk about a definition while you see the pictures. So here we have a steampunk laptop created by Doc Nodge. It's a fully functioning laptop, and this key here, you have to turn the key actually to turn it on. Like, you can't press a button, you have to turn the key. So as literary scholars Rachel Bowser and Brian Croxall explain, the key here is an example of the way steampunk, quote, does more than simply invoke a distant past. It creates a new paradigm in which technologies, aesthetics, and ideas mark different times simultaneously. You have a computer and the key. Instead of signposting different historical periods, anachronism is not anomalous, but it becomes the norm. So for them, for these two scholars, that notion of anachronism is vital to the way steampunk works, because it shows how steampunk, quote, rebels against the system it portrays. This rebelling is very important. Critiquing the system's lack of mercy and how its cutthroat capitalism treats both the haves and the have-nots. So in this way, steampunk, which is a term that was coined in 1987, is very much inheriting the politics of its sound-alike genre, cyberpunk, which is a science fiction genre. Like cyberpunks, steampunks are tinkerers. But in our current era, in 2016, of MacBooks that can't be opened or iPhones that require special screwdrivers, Pentalobe screwdrivers to be opened, Bowser and Croxel point out that the steampunks are always opening things up and are always customizing them, which is something we can't do. That is, they point out that there is a DIY, a do-it-yourself ethic, that earns steampunk its punk stripes. Just like punk rock, they explain, steampunk shocks the mainstream into questioning its behaviors and values, specifically around the notions of technology. It's a politics about taking back control, especially as technology becomes more pervasive in our daily lives and yet more and more distant. Remember, all of us are carrying a supercomputer in our pockets, but there is probably only one or two people in this room other than I who have ever opened one up, or even could. By relocating the focus on a fantasy of a tinkerable past where you could fix things, Bowser and Croxel conclude steampunk encourages us, contemporary readers, to think about how we can tinker and rebuild our own worlds. We can follow Nodge's lead and try to build mechanical versions of electronic switches, for example. So the anachronism of steampunk invites a blurred hybridity, a blending of these two times, that puts both the present, computers, etc., in the past, but also puts the past, with its tinkerability and DIY ethic, in the present. This image is from one of the first steampunk graphic novels, Alan Moore and Kevin O'Neill's League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, which reimagines 1898 as a steam-driven dystopia. So in this graphic novel, Sherlock Holmes's nemesis, Professor Moriarty, hires James Bond's grandfather to put together a team featuring other 19th century literary characters to recover stolen technology. It gets very complicated. But we see a lot of the genre's tropes, a lot of the things the genre does, just in these images. So London is overbuilt. This is London. It's overbuilt, steamy, polluted, with chaotic dirigibles floating around, avoiding these cranes. The sharpness of Bond's attire, this is Bond's grandfather, the sharpness of his attire contrasts with the desaturated filth that makes up most of the page. So keep this disorder in mind when considering another view of steampunk. So if the term steampunk was coined in a letter in 1987, the first real work of the genre is considered 1990's The Difference Engine, a novel by William Gibson and Bruce Sterling. Literary scholar Patrick Yagoda uses The Difference Engine to build on this description of steampunk that Bowser and Croxel provide. For Yagoda, steampunk draws, quote, parallels between the Industrial Revolution of the 19th century and the Information Revolution of the late 20th century. So instead of insisting on oppositions between history and fiction, nostalgia and innovation, and old cultures and new technologies, steampunk texts link all of these together. Steampunk, Yagoda continues, explores the simultaneous need to live within history and to escape it, as well as the parallel need to sustain and oppose systems of control. This living and escaping, the sustaining and opposing, is held up by remembering the blurred relationship of the worlds within a work of literature with the worlds without, outside the work of literature. As Yagoda puts it succinctly, quote, steampunk demonstrates, perhaps more effectively than any other genre, that history and imagination are not opposed terms. Blurring these worlds together, finally, again has a political charge. The tinkering of steampunk allows us to tweak and change the world around us, presumably for the better. For Yagoda, the relationship is even more profound. While those in power can strategically adapt fictional conventions to maintain these systems of control, this process is always reversible. There is no system of power that can completely eliminate other types of stories that imagine future forms of justice and project them speculatively into the past. Steampunk has a revolutionary politics built into it. Steampunk isn't then about building utopias that we can run away to, an escapist kind of fiction that relies on breaking with the real world. As Yagoda concludes, steampunk is instead a, quote, engine of difference that generates worlds and histories that are wholly other and also our own. In being both, the both become one, giving spaces to challenge these societies of control, which are made up, as Gilles Deleuze explains, of limitless postponements, like Kafka's work, The Trial. Finally, pictured here is an image by Agli Zioma that appears slightly altered in Vilko Valanda. In the background here, we see two spires associated with Vilnius University, and in the foreground, we have Jonas Basanavičius, more about him later. And here he is flying in a vehicle he calls Longžirgis, or Dragonfly. So in comparison to the above definitions of steampunk given by literary scholars, considering three decades of work across two continents, the description given by Tapinas is short and direct. Steampunk for Tapinas is, quote, a genre of fiction where the action takes place either in the Victorian era or in an alternative history, and objects using steam and mechanical technologies are highlighted, unquote. A longer answer about what is steampunk, steampunkus, put together by Yeva Mikutiena, is available on the website of the novel, but it more or less hits the same beats. So at first glance, the question that's driving this lecture is answered pretty clearly. Bowser and Croxel give a clear explanation of what they feel is punk about steampunk. It has that DIY, do-it-yourself ethic that is a constant challenge to black box technology. You can't open your phone. That ability to tinker is especially vital as we get more and more alienated from our technology. It used to be possible to repair a car or a laptop. Now it isn't. Yagoda builds on this sentiment by adding to that DIY ethic a direct challenge to systems of power, especially the systems of control that have turned our daily life into a scene again from Kafka's Trial. The system can only be attacked from outside via difference, via competing systems that present alternative realities. Steampunk generates these alternative realities for us, and then we make alternative realities in our own worlds. But Tapinas' description has lost all of these punk elements. There's nothing here that creates the same kind of overt political charge that is invested in world-changing, world-toppling views. For Tapinas, steampunk is a question of setting, a question of mobilizing objects. World-changing recedes, revolution recedes, to bring to the front interesting anachronisms and amusing juxtapositions. Like, what if Jonas Basanavičius was a Leonardo da Vinci-like character, inventor of flying objects, instead of a medical doctor? So while Bowser and Croxel are prepared to answer what's so punk about steampunk, it's not clear that Tapinas is. One solution could be to forgive him, of course. As an author, his job is to create literary objects, not answer what steampunk is. And it is the task of literary scholars like Croxel, Bowser, Yagoda, myself, to study those works. So despite the fact that Tapinas attends readings dressed with an aviator cap and an aviator's white silk aviator scarf, and despite the fact that the term steampunk or steampunkus is all over the place in the novel and the various materials, including its title page, perhaps the author doesn't really care about the punk side of the term. Steam, yes, punk, no. But there is, I think, a value in looking at what a steampunk novel that doesn't have any punk in it still has to say. Vilko Valanda, then, in presenting an alternative history where Vilnius is a city-state, reframes the concept of the Lithuanian nation-state, at least as imagined by patriots like Jonas Basanavičius. Tapinas is writing a novel supercharged with reference to the present day, to the political landscape in which he crafted this work. In looking at what Vilko Valanda then has to say about 1905, we actually learn far more about 2013, when the novel came out. What's the point of being punk in 2013, though? Especially if you're a Lithuanian living in Vilnius with an already successful mainstream career in television. Who are Lithuania's current punks in the steampunk tradition, and can they maintain that political charge? Finally, most importantly, what does Vilko Valanda's relationship to the state tell us about the future of the state of Lithuania, or any similar state in the European Union? These are the big questions about this lecture. So answering these questions about 2013 requires looking more carefully at 1905, which actually requires looking back even further to 1870. So even though most of the action in Vilko Valanda takes place in April of 1905, the very first chapter, it opens with a chapter that takes place in 1870. This is a map from 1870. And here, that's funny, whatever, but here I want to focus on the image of Russia. The emancipation of Russian serfs in 1861 and the general liberalizing of the Russian state, or Russian society under Alexander II, weakened the central government. The result is that we have a Russian empire here that looks like a beggar. Various state ministers were also oligarchs, taking state funding for projects like railroads while also greatly enriching themselves. Sounds kind of familiar. The splendor of the Winter Palace in St. Petersburg stands in contrast to an empire that is effectively bankrupt. In Vilkovalanda, this bankrupt Russian government is listening to an offer. In the first chapter, they're listening to an offer from the Rothschild family to buy two cities, Vilnius and Reval. The Rothschilds had already bought and freed Prague and Krakow, and they were in negotiations with Constantinople. Prague, Krakow, Constantinople. The Russians are offended by the idea of selling cities to a Jewish family so that it can create an alliance of free states. Or free cities, sorry. But the Rothschilds offer to release Russia of all of its debt, and they have also bribed the ministers in question. So amid a torrent of anti-Semitic feeling, the ministers acquiesce. They agree. But already we can see here a peculiar historical quirk about the novel. These are the names used in the English translation of the novel. The novel uses historically precise city names, Constantinople and Reval, but the historically inaccurate Vilnius. Reval is now Tallinn, and Constantinople is now Istanbul. And on this map here, this is an American map from 1911, and both cities are named as such. So Reval is named Reval, you can't see it here. Constantinople is named Constantinople, it says so here. But Vilnius is not named Vilnius. The cartographers wrote there Vilna. In contemporary Estonian travel literature, Reval is given as the, quote, German name for Tallinn, suggesting that the name Tallinn is somehow older, more authentically Estonian. In the same way, the name Vilnius is considered older and more authentically Lithuanian than the Russian and Polish forms of Vilna or Vilna. The city of Vilnius is given then a modern, or ancient, depending, name, while Tallinn is given a historically appropriate name. Even from the first chapter of the novel, then, it is clear that the text is doing a lot of political work. It agitates for a Lithuanian nationalism, both within the context of the plot, but also for the reader. And Tapinas uses authentic turn-of-the-century names for Vilnius neighborhoods, like Pohljanka or Antokol, but that authenticity is then undone by referring to the city throughout as Vilnius, even in English, in Lithuanian and in English. So before turning to the 1905 of Vilnius's Vilnius of 1905 in Tapinas' novel, it's instructive to look at the actual Vilnius of the time. Here's a contemporary painting by the Russian-Lithuanian artist Mstislav Dvozhinsky, who was living in Vilnius at the time. As the Lithuanian National Gallery admits, most artists in Vilnius at the time were Russians, Poles, or Jews. And this was for a very clear reason. In Vilnius at the time, most of the people in Vilnius were Russian, Polish, or Jewish. According to the 1897 Russian census, which measured mother tongues, of the 150,000 inhabitants of Vilnius, the most common language in the city was Yiddish, or as it's written in the census, Yevreisky, spoken by about 40% of the population. The next most common language was Polish, which accounted for just over 30th, and Russian, Ukrainian, Belarusian make up most of the rest of the pie, leaving about 2% for native speakers of Lithuanian and 1% for native speakers of German. As Timothy Snyder notes, 1909 count gave more or less the same numbers. So given this linguistic mix, it makes sense why scholars of the city, like Laimonas Briedis, often fret over what to even call the city that they're writing about. But among that 2% of people whose native language was Lithuanian, we can include Jonas Basanavičius. He spent the first 20 years of his professional career as a medical doctor in Bulgaria and Prague, but he settled in Vilnius in 1904, where he organized various activities related to raising the profile of Lithuanian culture, history, and language, taking advantage of the recent unrest in the Russian Empire. That is to say, at the time, the Russian Empire was busy getting humiliated in the Russo-Japanese War, including losing basically its entire navy at the Battle of Tsushima. The challenges to the strength of the government led to the revolution of 1905, which led to the October Manifesto, promising basic freedoms, the Russian October Manifesto. The manifesto then led to the Great Seimas of Vilnius at the end of 1905, which was an opportunity for Lithuanians to agitate for independence. But as a prelude to the meeting, Basanavičius and three others drafted a memorandum sent to Sergei Vita, the Russian prime minister. And the memorandum includes 10 theses, of which the first is largely quoted here. According to Basanavičius and his co-authors, the Poles, Jews, Russians, and others, remember, the people who made up 98% of the population of Vilnius, were nothing more than newcomers. The Lithuanian National Project relied on a campaign of delegitimizing the claim of 98% of the population of Vilnius and their history of the city, in that city. Note that this document was being drafted by a man who himself had just moved to Vilnius in the last year. But I should also note that the authors here in this memorandum are speaking about Lithuania as a whole, which to them included all of current Lithuania plus a bunch more. And there's no doubt that in 1905, Lithuanians made up large portions of most of this area. In the Kovenskaya gubernia, for example, two-thirds of the population spoke Lithuanian as their first language, and Lithuanians were a slim majority in the Suvalkskaya gubernia, which included Basanavičius' birthplace. But thinking that Vilnius was a city, Vilnius the city was only recently not Lithuanian by newcomers, is simply put a fantasy. Luckily, fantasy is precisely what we get with Vilko Valanda. At the same time that the real world Basanavičius, so this is Basanavičius again in Vilko Valanda, at the same time that the real world Basanavičius is writing that Russians, Poles, and Jews were newcomers, in the fantasy of the novel, he is instead the chair of the Department of Alchemy at Vilnius University, as well as alchemist advisor to the City Council of Vilnius, which runs the city. Basanavičius remarks on the Lithuania beyond Vilnius while flying in Dragonfly, quote, a land occupied by the Russian Empire, he calls it, drawing attention to the ring of railroads that the Russian Empire has built in the fake world. They've built around Vilnius to keep Russians from getting in and to keep liberal ideas from escaping out, presumably. But what a Vilnius it is at the time. The Alliance alchemists discovered a magical gas called Prometheus that let them unleash a revolution in blimp-based air travel. You can see a blimp here. Which is, of course, what unites the various cities of the Alliance. Vilnius, a stronghold of the alchemists, becomes an industrial center, not the sleepy capital, provincial capital it was, actually, at the time. So what is now Žirmūnai in the novel is Steamtown. And Gediminas Castle is now air traffic control for the blimps. And in fact, Tapinas uses the second and third chapters of the novel to introduce this new city to us. In the third chapter, Basanavičius flies from his office in the university here, it says university here, he flies to Žvėrynas to visit his friend, quiet, sleepy Žvėrynas. And in the second chapter, we follow a secret Russian agent who's leaving Steamtown, goes to Šnipiškės to get some money, and then walks down Vilnius Street here, then goes through the white gates here, and then cuts into Bėdos, which the novel translates as the Troubles, which is the rambunctious Faubourg-like area of chaos and crime just past the white columns at the end of what today is, coincidentally, Basanavičius Street. But between walking down Vilnius Street and getting to the white gates, he walks through this other neighborhood, Pohlyanka, that's known for its buzzing social and cultural life, symbolized by the many sidewalk cafes. So, this I'll read. All the quotes from the text I translated, so if they're bad, it's my fault. It was joyful in Pohlyanka. At the tables, one could variously hear Lithuanian, Polish, Russian, German, and even English, but the majority spoke Lithuanian. By Alliance decree, that was the primary language in Vilnius, and rector of the university dominion, Gimbutas, enforced this decree with pleasure. There seems to be a language missing here. What the narrator describes here could be mistaken for a snapshot of contemporary Vilnius, with its sidewalk cafes along Vokiečių Street and Vilnius Street, where certainly many languages do buzz, including all of these. But just like today, we never hear Yiddish in the streets of Vilnius. The same is apparently true for the Vilnius of Vilko Valanda. Yet, Tapinas' novel doesn't lack for Jewish character. After all, it was the Rothschild family that bankrolled the creation of the Alliance in the first place. And the novel has many minor Jewish characters, even though they routinely slide into anti-Semitic stereotypes. Vexilidis, one of the characters, the narrator calls, quote, a slippery little Jew. Yet when the novel insists that it was the Alliance that made Vilnius attractive to the Jewish people, it misrepresents centuries of relative tolerance already extended to the Jewish community. That is, Vilna, as the Jewish population called the city, was already a beacon for Jews. That had been the case for centuries. It didn't need the alliance. Similarly, the narrator gives the fictional alliance of free cities too much credit for its own tolerance. For example, there was a law forbidding where Jews could live, and it had already been repealed in 1861 by the Russian Empire, not by a city council of an invented, pretend free city of Vilnius in this novel. That is to say, the novel argues that Vilnius was a haven for Jews because of the alliance of free cities, that it required this fictional space to become a haven for Jews, ignoring the fact that it was already a pretty good place. It wasn't perfect, but it was a pretty good place for them to live. Remember, the Jewish population made up, again, 40% of the Vilnius population. So in the process of making Vilnius a Lithuanian city, the novel erases its Jewish character. Yiddish isn't heard in the cafes, and the characters are all stereotypes. This erasure, of course, is not so different from what actually happened in our world after the Holocaust. Vilnius' enormous pre-Holocaust Jewish population was replaced by Lithuanians who moved in from the countryside. So ignoring centuries of defining Lithuanian urban life, Jews were to patriots like Basanavičius merely a population in transition, newcomers, wanderers. And the same is true in this novel. Wanderers, newcomers. This is what has become of the largest ethnic group in the real Vilnius in 1897 and in 1909. They have been reduced to minority status alongside ethnic groups that probably never accounted for more than 2% of the population of Vilnius, like Tatars, Karaites, Hungarians, the French, and Lithuanians, at least until the Holocaust. Vilko Valanda repeats the nationalist politics of the real Basanavičius by getting rid of non-Lithuanian aspects of Vilnius to make them seem more Lithuanian. But the brunt of the labor of that Lithuanianization is borne by the disappeared Jewish population. And this population lives largely in Juodese, or as the English translation calls it, the blots. The Jewish presence in Vilnius is a blot on the city. And once a piece of paper or a city is ruined by a blot, all one can do is cut it out and throw it away. Most perplexing, however, is this line. In this line of thinking is the main character of the novel, whom I already mentioned here. This is him. He's the head of the police force in Vilnius, and his name is Antanas Sidabras, and he's a former U.S. Marine who fought in the Spanish-American War. In the graphic novel that I showed earlier about his escapades in Arizona, we learn that his name is Anthony Silver. Silver, the same name as Abba Hillel Silver, the Zionist rabbi who was born in what's now Kudirkos Naumiestas. Silver, the same last name as Eliezer Silver, the rabbi born near Rokiškis, who as president of Vlad Hatzala helped save thousands of Jews in the Second World War. Silver, a name probably shared by hundreds, if not thousands, of Jews scattered throughout turn of the century in Lithuania. And yet in this novel, the last name is borne by a character who's a Gentile. Considering what did happen to that Jewish population in the real world, its mishandling and erasure by Tapinas avant la guerre is in astonishingly poor taste. But it does make Vilnius more legible to contemporary readers. We don't hear Yiddish in sidewalk cafes, though we do hear English. This is consistent with the novel. There are other little nods to the audience, parts of this anachronistic bending, this blending of the two historical time periods that suggest how the story is playing with our expectations. Here, for example, again, Sidabras is speaking to his favorite informant, an older beggar who is always dressed up like she's about to go out on a date. In this way, she recalls a famous current beggar of Vilnius, Vilnius Roja. And fittingly, the woman is called Roja in the novel as well. Additionally, there's another character in the novel called Solomon Klein, who covers the walls of Vilnius with graffiti. Again, this should bring a chuckle to any current Vilnius inhabitant's face, because Solomon is one of the most notorious taggers in Vilnius, covering nearly every naked wall with his tag. In fact, capturing Solomon has become a cause among the chattering classes in contemporary Lithuania, of which Tapinas is, of course, a member. Now, the case of Solomon Klein also lets us move away from the Vilnius of the novel, of this novel, that is free of its Jewish inhabitants, and now we can instead move towards the labor issues of the novel. Solomon Klein is, as his name suggests, a slight boy of 14. He joins Utopia, an anarchist terrorist group or whatever, and he finds his way to Vilnius, where every night he receives money and instructions to paint a specific phrase in one place, or somewhere in the city. And the phrase is, Darbo donos ir teisybės, work, bread, and truth. And the slogan appears midway through the novel and drives a second plot. So the first half of the novel is mostly a murder investigation. Then when you start seeing this graffiti, labor unrest becomes a second issue. Sidabras is busy solving that murder, and now he has to solve this problem too, because this slogan is causing labor unrest among the working class of Vilnius. So that there was labor unrest in Vilnius in 1905 is probably not a big surprise. After all, as I mentioned before, 1905 was a very important year in Russian history because it was the year of the 1905 Russian Revolution. Now, the revolution was considered during the Soviet era, as this poster shows, to be a trailblazing revolution that led to the larger revolution of 1917. And I have to underscore that there's literally no mention of this revolution in Vilkovalanda. None. Who knows if it happens in this alternative history? It maybe doesn't. The novel takes place in April of 1905, and the Russo-Japanese War does happen in the alternative history. But the narrator makes no mention, for example, of Bloody Sunday, which happened in January of 1905, where several hundred petitioners were shot by imperial troops in front of the William Winter Palace in St. Petersburg. The novel, however, does allude to this revolution, or at least to the general problems regarding labor throughout the industrialized and industrializing world at the start of the 20th century. Sidabras meets, for example, with the engineer Patras Vileišis, who in this alternative history is the leader of the Mechanics Guild and the steam advisor to the city council. Vileišis, who's speaking here, blames the labor unrest in the city on an influx of foreign laborers. They are coming in from Russia and are willing to work for less money and illegally, unlike the locals. This echoes the sort of steal our jobs mentality that we're used to hearing in the contemporary US and UK. But as it happened throughout much of the 19th century in much of Europe and the US, industry boomed, and as industry grew, so did cities, which needed more and more people to work in their factories. But then the workers started agitating for their rights. Vileišis relies, on a paternalistic view of management, where labor has no cause for collective action, for striking, because he is ahead of the ball. He gives them good wages and good working conditions. They have no reason to strike. But it's not just the foreigners that are making the workers worried about their futures. Automation is also worrying them. As the mechanists and alchemists get better at building their robots that can build things, less and less labor will be needed from the working class. So the workers plan to take matters into their own hands and strike for better conditions. This is the second part of the novel. In fact, the workers plan two separate actions during the course of the novel. At the same time, Vilnius is hosting this huge summit where leaders from all around Europe fly together and it's confusing and whatever, but they plan two things. They plan a general strike in Steamtown, and their wives plan a mother's march on City Hall to petition the government for and demand work, bread, and justice for their families. Both events parallel the 1905 revolution. There were also general strikes in the 1905 revolution, and there was petitioners marching to the government with Bloody Sunday, where they got shot down by the imperial troops. And in the novel, both events are also thwarted. Vileišis collaborates with the university and with the Vilnius city government to finance and release a new newspaper, Vilnius Žinios, on the day of the strike that delegitimizes the strike leaders. The workers read this new newspaper and they give up. They decide they won't strike. The real Vileišis, of course, published a newspaper as well, where he took advantage of the end of the Lithuanian press ban in 1904. The Mother's March on City Hall, on the other hand, is broken up by the Cathedral Knights, a Catholic paramilitary organization. Their leader, Prelate Theodoros Masalskis, is also the spiritual advisor of the city council, and he shames the mothers into stopping their fight by telling them that prayer will answer what they want, not striking. And just as Sidabras is relieved to see that he no longer has to deal with a general strike, his top lieutenant, Vilhovsky, is similarly relieved that the mother's march is also dispersed without bloodshed. Now, I linger on these two instances, maybe a little bit too long, the strike and the mother's march, because of whom the narrator whom the novel wants us to cheer for. As I mentioned, the chief of the Vilnius Legion, the top cop of the city, is Antanas Sidabras, and he's the main character of the novel. His adventures are typically portrayed as heroic, and in his efforts to save the city and bring order to the city. But he, along with Vilesius Masalskis and earlier Basanavičius, are the agents of state power. So the novel wants us to cheer for the people in charge as they deal with these two blows, as they deal two blows to the working class community of Vilnius. The city, it seems, then has no place for a working class that has its own voice. It is interested only in the voice of the elite, the city council advisors, and the like. But Vilko Valanda provides yet another twist on this. The novel refuses to give the workers enough self-awareness, enough class consciousness, if you were, to actually have agitated for improving their lives in the first place. It turns out, we learn in the novel, well actually the reader knew all along, but I hid it from you, that the strikes were not a sui generis response to the labor conditions in Vilnius. Instead, the strikes are intentional acts of sabotage by the Russian government. The Tsar's forces infiltrated the workers' groups and the mothers' groups in the churches, the church groups, and convinced the workers to strike. The fact that Steamtown is covered in grotesque pollution, that's not a reason. That doesn't matter. The gap between the rich and poor in the novel, that doesn't matter. The fact that the working class has no way to redress its grievances, that doesn't matter. The meek inherit nothing in Vilko Valanda, despite what Masalskis says. They don't even have a voice. All they can do is respond to provocations by Russian agents. Though they may have legitimate grievances, they are short-circuited by the plot's need to vilify Russia. Throughout, we're told that the living conditions are horrible. But even so, the only reason the workers seem to that the workers would ever strike is just because they're bribed by Russia. So the Vilnius of Vilko Valanda ends up creating this triad of Neo-Victorianism, Neo-Nazism, and Neo-Liberalism. The Neo-Victorian aspect is apparent in the way that the novel conjures up the steampunk aesthetic in setting itself in a 1905 Vilnius that run by steam and alchemy. It even extends its Victorian flourishes by placing part of the novel at Sandhurst, the Royal Military Academy, where two English cadets get ready to go on their first mission in Vilnius. But the steampunk remains forever merely along the surface, perhaps precisely where it should be as a wholly aesthetic effect. Recall how Bowser and Kroxel see steampunk as an ethic that appears deeply embedded in the works of steampunk. That punkness is always there, either through its DIY-ness or its link to revolutionary political sentiments. For Tapinas, however, steampunk is an aesthetic, a window dressing. It's a question of setting and object choice. Whatever revolutionary politics the novel features are revealed to be wholly inauthentic and otherwise bribed by the Russian Empire, financed by the Russian Empire. The tinkerers in this novel are not interested in changing the world. They're interested in restoring order. They fight to maintain the legitimacy of those in power. In fact, in the personae of Basanavičius and Vilesius, they are the ones in power. Those are the tinkerers in this novel. So as steampunk, the novel clearly fails. There's little to nothing punk about it. Its Neo-Victorianism is merely a hook to draw on the reader as something interesting. Bringing up a term like Neo-Nazism is a much stronger claim, and I do not argue that Tapinas or the novel or any of its characters are Neo-Nazis. I have to underscore that. But I do argue that the novel does the work of Neo-Nazis for them. Tapinas makes great efforts to present the multicultural Vilnius of 1905, and he even has a minor character who is mocked for his backwards nationalist Lithuanians for Lithuanians line of thinking. But Tapinas still creates a Vilnius full of Lithuanians at the expense of the Jewish population. He demolishes the Jewish presence in Vilnius by reducing them to a mere minority whose language is not even heard in the street. And that kind of silencing has direct consequences in contemporary Lithuania. So here's a picture I took back in 2014. Can anyone tell where this is? Yeah, this is Žydų gatvė, the Jewish street. So this is a street sign that says Jewish street, or ST. And along the street was the grand old synagogue of Vilna, several shops, other houses of prayer. They're all gone now. We know why. Worse, covering the street sign is a sticker calling for Lithuanians to vote in the referendum that for a ban on foreign ownership of land in Lithuania. Whoever stuck this sticker across the word Jewish clearly interprets the threat of foreign ownership of land in Lithuania with the return of the Jewish population to the body politic. The neo-Nazi who put up the sticker, and it was a neo-Nazi, I guarantee, prefers a Lithuania, a Vilnius, completely empty of Jews, where you never hear Yiddish, and where their numbers are comparable to those of Hungarians or Tatars. And it's funny, because Lithuanian authors are capable of capturing the nuance of the old vanished Jewish Vilnius. Kristina Sabaliauskaitė, for example, did as much in her short story Vilnius Vilnero Sugrįžimas, which was written and released around the same time as this novel. So Tapinas' erasure is sloppy craftsmanship, I don't know, but he's regurgitating a very foul vision of Lithuania. Finally, neoliberalism. When I use this term, I have in mind two specific tendencies. The first is a means by which the state takes a greater interest in the economic well-being of its donors and corporations than in the general well-being of its citizenry as a whole. We see this in this is Margaret Thatcher's famous quote about how there is no such thing as society, there are only individuals and families, and these individuals and families are the primary points of change within the body politic, not the government. So as we saw with the strike breaking in Vilkovalanda, the state is interested not in the quality of life of the working class, but rather in the continued smooth running of the production chain that brings profits to the city's various private enterprises. Remember, the government pays for and launches its own newspaper to encourage the workers not to strike. For however much we may mock the state-run media in the Soviet Union and in contemporary Russia, Tapinas' Vilnius is doing the exact same thing. But we're encouraged to cheer for its arrival, because it gives Sidabras one fewer headache. The novel does not let the workers coalesce to speak in one voice as an aggrieved class. They're always either bribed or misled individuals. There is no working class, there is no society. Additionally, when the Mother's March is broken up, the cathedral knights refuse the mothers their class standing, and Masalskis instead tells them to go back home, think of your families, don't think about society, there are only individuals and families. And this relationship between the state and capital is a very specific form of the second sense of neoliberalism, which is the general sense of the commodification or entrepreneurialization of everyday life. That is, the feeling of the market, the freeing of the market, sorry, and opening up what can be exchanged in the free market. Stop whining about workers' rights, the novel tells us, and instead become one of those people who look to themselves first and strive as a member of the freelance, gig, or precarious economy. Look after your own concerns, not those of your neighbors. And in order to make looking to yourself as easy as possible, we should deregulate the government, privatize state-run assets, minimize the role of government in daily life. The government, after all, is interested in society. But if society doesn't exist, then what's the government going to do? Make it easier for people to look for themselves. So this is one of a set of maps I made after the 2012 parliamentary elections in Lithuania. Elections that took place as Tapinas was writing this novel, Vilkovalanda. Nationally, the Social Democrats won the plurality and built a coalition government. But this map shows how the strongest neoliberal party, the Liberals, did in the voting. So basically, where the darker red it is, the worse they did, and the darker blue it is, the better they did. This is Vilnius, this is Kaunas, this is Klaipėda. So it's clear where the Liberals' power base is. They're an urban party, if not even an urbane party, because they support many policies that we take for granted here in the U.S., especially regarding same-sex relationships and this sort. In fact, so we see the Liberals did very well in especially the nice parts of Vilnius. And in fact, all the parties that did well in those nice parts of Vilnius, the Liberals and the Conservatives, are currently in the opposition in the Lithuanian parliament. So we don't know what kind of coalition will be running Lithuania after this fall's elections, but recent polls show that the map on the previous slide is not mistaken. The countryside is supporting, for the most part, two parties, Social Democrats and the Peasants and Greens, and the cities are supporting, for the most part, and you know, recent scandals have come to light and so on, but for the most part, the cities are supporting the Liberals and Conservatives. The gaps between the cities and the countryside will continue to grow. And Vilnius embodies that growing gap by positioning itself as a tech hub with a neoliberal government interested both in deregulation and in freelance startup culture. This is the current mayor, the liberal mayor. He's in Amsterdam hanging out with Uber. So in this sense, current Vilnius is very DIY. It's a city awash with dreams of making millions from your great iPhone app idea. Or maybe just hundreds by being an Uber driver, because you need to supplement your otherwise paltry wages. On the other hand, the countryside is disconnected from this bright future. In Vilkovalanda, remember, Vilnius stands alone as a beacon of prosperity and industry that attracts immigrants from the rest of, from the Lithuanian parts of Russia surrounding it. This mirrors real life, because in the last 5 years, the population of Vilnius has grown, whereas all the rest of Lithuania has gone down. Just as in the novel, everyone is leaving the countryside to come to the big city. So, and once you're in the city, don't complain. If you can't make money, it's your own fault for not being a good enough entrepreneur, for not being DIY enough, and for not being willing, as Thatcher says, to be a person looking for themselves first. So, it might be strange to close out a discussion of neoliberalism, I'm finishing up here, with a nod to a very famous quote by a very famous communist, but I promised nation-states, city-states, and withered states, so here you have the withered state. Vilkovalanda, just like Lithuanian politics, and like most of the European Union, is in a bind, in a contradiction with no clear way out. On the one hand, the novel, and Lithuania and the European Union, is very dependent on identity politics that position a person's nationality ahead of other considerations. Tapinas' silencing of the Jewish heritage of the city reinforces the racism and or anti-Semitism inherent in the process of nation-state building. You can't build a nation without some element of racism. So it's no surprise that it relies on the same exact rationale for Lithuanian dominance over the city of Vilnius that the nationalists plotting in 1905 did. Paradoxically, though, once we're all entrepreneurial neoliberal subjects, our national identities should no longer matter. In the novel, for example, the Vilnius Legion, the police, is made up almost entirely of American and British soldiers. Why? Because the city decided that earlier law enforcement officials in Russian Vilnius were incapable of the job, even though they may have been ethnically Lithuanian. The imperial gendarmes, with their propensity for bribes, for laziness, they couldn't do the job. They did not earn their jobs on merit. So the novel's Vilnius City Council acts in a very neoliberal manner. They outsourced law enforcement to a new organization, the Vilnius Legion, hired a bunch of very expensive consultants from abroad, and paid them. These Americans and Brits earn their jobs on merit, and their huge salaries are justified as a counter-corruption measure. In this version of events, however, eventually Vilnius will be flooded with foreign labor and capital that has earned, on merit, the right to be there. In what might be a vision of the future of Vilnius as a tech center, these entrepreneurs will take these opportunities away from Lithuanians who are struggling in underfunded yet ridiculously overpriced public universities. The Lithuanian state will then wither away, and the most important factor in a person's life is will become whether they are the best at taking care of themselves first. So why worry about those poor, underqualified Lithuanians? Vilkovalanda makes use of a clever narrative trick to make the reader not worry about those poor, underqualified Lithuanians. First, it refuses the validity of their claims by presenting them as just Russian pawns. But second, it does so simply by actually kicking out the majority of Lithuanians out of the story. Remember, while Vilnius in the novel is achieving all these technological marvels, the area around it, the part of the country that actually historically was Lithuanian, is left in the hands of the incompetent and evil Russian Empire. Those poor, underqualified Lithuanians are still in Russia, where they cannot slow down Vilnius's rise to technological greatness. The state withers away and becomes literally smaller and smaller and smaller. First it's a nation state, then it's a city state. As it gets smaller, it makes sure that the citizenry is only of the best quality. The Vilnius of Vilkovalanda resembles in part this libertarian fantasy of the seastead. Note the blimp, very steampunk. Seasteading, where the rich, like PayPal's co-founder Peter Thiel, can create tiny cities outside of any kind of government interference. As the Seasteading Institute's founder, Patry Friedman, points out, changing your system of government is as easy as just detaching your stead and floating off to another one somewhere else. The rest of the people, they get washed away, forgotten and abandoned. Let the Russians have the poor. After all, they're bribing them already. Steampunk novels are supposed to challenge our view of the world around us. There are the hyperactive anachronism, the over-apparent hybridization, and the clear ruptures with history encourage us to write our own history. This revolutionary promise stands in contrast, as Yagoda notes, with the, quote, strategic production of histories that uphold an existing configuration of power. The machines quoted here, in this quote, are owned by the government and the difference engine, and they spit out their own version of history that consolidates the status quo. We tell history this way, so you think that things are normal. Instead of creating a novel that challenges us with its anachronism and hybridization and inspires us to rebuild the world around us, Tapinas has instead created the kind of light pop that flatters the reader and captures our interest just long enough to distract us from how it itself is one of these machines, spinning out the histories that uphold the existing configuration of power. Vilnius was always Lithuanian, it tells us, and never Jewish, it tells us. A government's main role is encouraging business to thrive, it tells us, especially if that involves improving the tech startup sector, it tells us. Labor unions exist only because the Russian government funds them, it tells us, and so on. Reviewing Vilko Valanda for Knygų Aidai, Rūta Lazauskaitė notes that the novel is, by any standard, completely pop. It has been actively popularized in various media. It is sold popularly and even was voted by popular vote the book of the year in 2013. But Lazauskaitė drifts away from pointing out that the pop nature of the novel means that it is a way written for maximum appeal to various social strata. She's making a too, in my opinion, a too economical claim of the role of popular culture or of mass culture. For me, it makes more sense to look to what Siegfried Krakauer, writing in Weimar, Germany, had to say about popular cinema. Quote, a producer will never allow himself to be driven to present material that in any way attacks the foundations of society. Indeed, the films made for the lower classes are even more bourgeois than those aimed at finer audiences because they smuggle in a respectable way of thinking. Pop does not exist just to make money, though it does. It makes a lot of money. Pop also exists as a machine spinning out history. Pop fiction reflects how the EU presents itself as a dehistoricized, continuously self-reaffirming process of greater consolidation of capital and power. Vilko Valanda pulls on the mantle of steampunk and pretends to be a wolf in sheep's clothing, tearing away at this EU consensus. It threatens to be that punk that tears everything down and causes us to rebuild our world after we see how it could be different. But instead, however, the work is the opposite. It's not a wolf in sheep's clothing at all. It's rather a sheep dressed up as a terrifying iron wolf. It's neoliberalism's perfect kind of punk, favorite kind of punk, the kind who just makes some noise but never changes anything. And still, the rich get richer. So thank you very much. The slides are up here. The bibliography is here, the last two slides. And yeah, a lot of lights.